ladies and gentlemen, asked Deepinder to let me have a few words at the beginning and then hand over the proceedings to our speaker. The reason I've asked to say a few words is because we really ought to ask ourselves, what is the trade-off? I mean, we are a think tank and a policy institute. Why do we organize poetry readings, literature salons, and today, what I think is a promising picture show? The one answer would be, we are all human beings and we like pretty pictures, we like poetry, we like literature. That would be the wrong answer. Because if that is the reason why we are here, well, we shouldn't be. Because we are here during work time. Look at pictures all you want after your work is done. So how does our work and these pictures, this poetry and this literature connect? Until that work is done, I think the rest will go in the wash. So let's ask ourselves, why do we need to step out of public policy in order to come back to it richer? I'm a latecomer to this line of thinking because I was trained at a university in a department where I was told what can't be expressed in numbers need not be mentioned at all in the graduate school. That was the University of Rochester, the hardest of positivist schools in political science. Much later in life, I realized that there are many ways to package reality than numbers. And the most moving one actually are not the numbers at all, but pictures, sounds, visualization. If you don't believe this, look at what the Taliban did to the Bamiyan Buddha, what ISI is doing right now. You can just call it vandalism and leave it there. There are lots of political commentators whose political sophistication is not any deeper than yesterday's newspaper. If you think about it seriously, you'd know there is a connection somewhere to a hole in the heart and awful things outside. That is the ultimate mile that we as analysts have to go. And for that, what you see, what you hear, is just as important or sometimes even more important, especially when one is talking about experiences outside the box, outside the ken of liberal democracy. That is where I want all of us to look at visual material, qualitative material, and then think through our political science, our economics, our sociology, and bring some public policy into it. I did work with a group of art historians and wrote a piece called Iconizing the Nation, comparing Bharat Mata and Marianne, and I learned a lot from what pictures can tell. Before I hand over the proceedings, allow me to put it this way, there is no such thing called an honest photograph. A photograph is what the photographer saw and chose to show you. So what is behind the picture? What is that thread that connects visualization with the concept that underpins it? That, I think, is where we'll have to engage you in a proper conversation after your talk. So thanks for giving me a few minutes, Deepinder. I now hand it over to you.
Thank you very much, Professor Mitra. Good morning and a very warm welcome to the seminar on the many lives of Homai Vyarawala. We're actually delighted in having with us Professor Sabina Gadihok. Professor Gadihok is Associate Professor of Video Production at Jamia Millia Islamia in New Delhi. The eagle-eyed amongst you would have seen the brief CV that's in the brochure. Let me mention a few points that go beyond that. Professor Gadihok has also produced several generations of very creative independent documentary filmmakers in Delhi. She herself has been a member of a very powerful and influential film collective called Media Storm, which has, amongst other productions, a film on Sati. Another one, relatively more recent years, on the Night Fairies of Calcutta. This is a film which is shown in juxtaposition to an Oscar award-winning film on the same theme a few years ago. Received a lot of critical acclaim at Harvard, Oxford, and other media circles as well. She's also been active in the Track 2 diplomacy in the South Asian community, in particular in working with young and upcoming Pakistani filmmakers. The work on Homai Vyarawala is really significant. Just to put a context, I wouldn't be out of line in saying that Homai, Ms. Vyarawala, figures in the same retinue of giants as such as Margaret Bourke-White and Henri Cartier-Bresson. I remember the first time you see these photographs, they're utterly breathtaking. And there are a few things that you notice about these. I mean, these are luminaries, the like, you know, there's a steady stream of luminaries coming to India at the time. Queen Elizabeth, the Duke of Edinburgh, President Kennedy, Mrs. Kennedy, Joseph Broz Tito, President Suharto, Gamal Abdel Nasser, and legions of others. And one of the things that you notice is, from the photographers, most of them are looking directly into the face of the camera. And part of that is just an outcome of the fact that it's a relatively, amongst a large cohort of men, there's a single woman standing, and that catches your eye as well. I shan't go very further on that. The book and the other documentaries tell you a lot. There's a very powerful award-winning documentary that's come out of this as well, called Three Women and a Camera. And a couple of days ago, I learned that Professor Gary Hoke herself is the subject of a documentary on filmmakers across the women camera persons across the world, and there are very few of them, and even fewer who go on to do independent productions themselves as well. So she's in a unique legion of her own in that sense, certainly. This is an extraordinary treasure trove of archival material, and there's relatively recently discovered archives, which show a different aspect from what you would see in traditional settings from the 40s and 50s, which is photographs of the giants of the independence movement. These are ordinary folks, photographs of ordinary folks, of the elite, the remnants of the empire, and they provide a very powerful catalog of what transpired, the strong sociological changes that the country was being brought through at that period. And that sense, it provides a very powerful visual narrative. We're also pleased to have in our midst Mrs. Gaddy Hoke, who along with the later Admiral Gaddy Hoke was witness to many of the transformations that took place at that time. Welcome to her. Without much ado, I'll now hand over the mic to Professor Gaddy Hoke.
Thank you very much, Dipinder and Professor Mitra, for that wonderful warm welcome. And I'm very thankful to the Institute of South Asian Studies to host me here. I'm going to get into my talk because I don't want to be longer than 40 or 45 minutes. So I'm going to start by describing a movie clip that I'm not going to show you right now. I'm going to show that to you right at the end. It's a clip from an archival film that was shot on the morning of 15th of August 1947, which is the day that India became independent. It's color footage, very rare footage. And the swearing-in ceremony, I'm going to describe it, the swearing-in ceremony of Jawaharlal Nehru as the first prime minister had just concluded. And after this more exclusive event, a guard of honor led a ceremonial carriage carrying the first governor general and his wife down the road so that people could cheer and celebrate this euphoric moment. You see that in this photograph that Homai took. And as press photographers ran along with the carriage, one could almost miss a small detail in the foreground. A woman dressed in a white khadi sari runs across the frame with two cameras. The shot lasts for just a few seconds as the film camera returns to the more famous protagonist of this moment of nationalist history. And a few minutes later, of course, she would take this picture. I'm going to show you that clip right at the end of my talk. So that's like the tantalizing thing that you're going to see at the end. Now, I find this brief cameo in the film of Homai Vairavala, her own presence within that film, very interesting because it frames her within a mainstream nationalist discourse, even while it challenges it by the presence of a seemingly marginal actor who happened to be a woman photographer at the time. So, you know, we're talking about all these big events and all these things happening, and then suddenly in the frame you see this, you know, figure of this woman who's really a marginal actor but equally critical to this history. Arguably India's first woman press photographer and the only one in her time, Vairavala passed away after celebrating her 98th birthday on the 15th of January in 2012. I was privileged to know her intimately for 15 years as her biographer, and in this talk I'd like to revisit and reflect on her many lives by tracking shifts in my own scholarship on her, which has of course lasted over the last 15 years. But first let me give you the biographical details. So Homai Vairavala photographed for over three decades from the late 1930s to 1970. This was an extremely significant part of Indian history that spanned the turbulence of independence, its euphoric early years, and the disillusionment with undelivered promises from the 60s. Homai's repertoire was vast, and we are still discovering the entire sweep of her work. In addition to being one of the key chroniclers of Nehruvian era politics, she photographed everyday urban life in Bombay and institutional and cultural life in Delhi. She also took scores of pictures of ordinary Indians, Dipinder has just referred to that, fancy dress parties, school events and marriages that she gave away to her subjects. And these pictures in a sense constitute what one could see as the missing archive of Homai Vairavala, because we don't have those pictures. I mean, they were given away to all these people. The story of Homai's life begins almost, starts more than a century ago in 1913. Those are pictures of Homai. In Navsari in Gujarat, where she was born, her father, Dosabhai Hathiram, was an actor in a traveling Urdu Parsi theater company that toured in countries like Burma and Malaysia and perhaps even Singapore. And Kathy Hansen has actually tracked the ups and downs in his fascinating life that was marked by intrigue and dramatic events. There were murders and all kinds of stuff. And she's writing a very interesting book now that will actually document the life of Homai's father. Homai herself was fascinated by the theater, and given a choice, she would have liked to be an actress. That's what she said to me. But choice wasn't really an option. It was not possible for girls from good middle-class families to become actresses in those days. And especially after her father's premature death, she urgently needed to earn a living. As it turned out, she made the right choice. Growing up in the city of Bombay, Homai met Manikshaw Vairavala, who was a self-taught photographer. She learned her photography from him. She married him a few years later. Here are some of her early hand-colored pictures of friends at the JJ School of Arts in Bombay, where she studied. You know, there were all these features that she would do for magazines. So this one is the Bombay Chronicle, dated 1941. And, you know, they were published in magazines. These are pictures that she took during the Second World War. And these are pictures of friends at the JJ School of Arts. And if you look carefully at the bottom, unfortunately, it's getting cut off here. They are credited to MJV, which is basically the initials of her husband. So her early pictures had to be published under the name of her husband. Manikshaw already contributed to pictorial magazines in Bombay, and it would have been difficult for an unknown photographer, particularly a woman, to gain entry. In these early days, she was often dismissed as just a girl. So Homai had to work hard at creating a reputation for herself. In 1942, Homai and her now husband Manikshaw moved to Delhi to join the publicity wing of the British war effort. The FEB had actually shifted to Singapore, and then, of course, you know, there was this whole propaganda effort during the Second World War. And this relocation changed the nature of her photography forever, catapulting Homai into a completely different world of mainstream nationalist politics in the capital. You have to keep in mind that her new job required her to cover major political events and important dignitaries. And these photographs, the ones that I'm going to show you now, represent this phase of Homai's work, which is her coverage of nationalist politics. I'm going to run you through some of her well-known and iconic pictures of important milestones in the life of the nation that have circulated widely after her rediscovery in the early 1990s. So let's say the events around independence. This is Lord Mountbatten outside the Parliament House on the morning of August 15th. You can see the jubilant crowd surrounding him. The funeral of Gandhi at Birla House, the body at Birla House. The crowds as the procession went to the cremation grounds. Lord Mountbatten, Edwina, and others, Rajkumari Amrit Kaur. You can see the daughter, all seated at the cremation ground at Rajghat. Gandhi's son, the first editor of the Hindustan Times, Devdas Gandhi, trying to control the crowds. This is a train carrying the urn to Allahabad for the immersion of the ashes. Crowds at every station as the train passed through Allahabad and went on to Sangam. Crowds running along with the train. Lord Mountbatten taking the salute for the last time in March 1948 before he left the country. This is at Rashtrapati Bhavan. And here is a photograph that represents another master narrative of Tibetan migration to India. This is a Dalai Lama crossing over into India in 1956 to attend a celebration of a Buddhist celebration marking 500 years of Buddhism. And you can see that he doesn't wear the robes of the bhikshu because he's still dressed in his brocade gown, you know, as a prince. And this is across, she went to the Nathula Pass in Sikkim to cover this, so he crossed on a pony. This is a very rare picture. The Dalai Lama, Nehru flanked on either side by the Dalai Lama and Chaman Lai, who was actually visiting India. And then, of course, the Dalai Lama years later in India. And 3 years later, after the event of his crossing on the pony, the Dalai Lama would cross over never to return to Tibet. And of course, this time, for obvious reasons, there would be no press photographers to document the crossing, if you know anything about how he actually crossed over. Now, then there is the curious absence in Homai's work, and that is partition. So let me go back for a minute. While she did not shoot the caravans, and she was always asked this question, why did you not shoot partition? And as a woman, I think it would have been difficult for her to actually, take that risk and actually document some of that. So while she did not shoot the caravans and the refugees, it's interesting to see what did she shoot during this time. One of the most obvious is official rituals. So she was present at a Congress committee meeting to ratify the 3rd June plan to partition India. And her stories tell the story visually of different reactions to partition. So here is an image of Mahatma Gandhi arriving for the meeting with Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan. Many important Congress leaders, including Nehru, raised their hands in partition during these pictures. And these are actually pictures where people are, by a show of hands, deciding on partition. So they are quite shocking in a sense, because it was a very important meeting where the Congress Working Committee actually ratified the 3rd June plan, which was a plan to partition the country. You see Nehru in that picture raising his hand as well. And obviously Maulana Azad is extremely upset about the decision, flanked by Rajaji on one side. And these pictures never really became part of our collective memory of partition and somehow escaped public scrutiny in the years to follow. While some of them were printed up in newspapers of the time, they have clearly been overshadowed by narratives of trauma. Images of refugees are one of the largest trans-border migrations in history. Perhaps one explanation for this could be the uncomfortable questions that they raise. And I will read out to you what Homai Vyarawala had to say about this occasion. I'm quoting from the book. I felt absolutely disappointed about partition. They were in a hurry to take power into their own hands. And if you see my pictures of the final meeting where they said raise hands for partition, you could see that there were very few people there. India is so big, they should have taken the consensus of people, but they didn't do that. Kripalani, who was a Congress president at the time, was in the chair and he was averse to our taking pictures. He allowed only 2 minutes for everybody to speak for or against, and if anybody tried to speak against it, he was made to sit down, and if someone was in its favor, they were allowed to speak. Sardar Patel then stood up and said, if you have gangrene on your arm or leg, you cut it off and finish with it. That was their idea of partition. But the gangrene is still there and it is progressing now. It was so frustrating to hear them talk like this. Mahatmaji was very unhappy and there was so much of pressure on him to say yes. They treated India like their own jagir. So these are her comments about this event. And this is a telling image of the people who were most affected by partition, ordinary people waiting to hear the verdict outside the meeting ground. Now, in her work on the long partition, Wazira Zamindar has drawn attention to how partition was not just an event within a given temporal span, but a set of recurring impulses that continue to reverberate for long after. taking a cue from Zamindar, I suggest that there could be other ways of looking at partition narratives in Homai's work, and that is through absence or what is concealed in her frames. This one, for instance, of Connaught Place in New Delhi, it's one of her most iconic pictures taken in the early 1950s, masks a dark partition story of displacement and forcible occupation. During the weeks and months of violence in Delhi, Homai and her husband would stand chatting on the balcony of their home in Connaught Place. So this picture is taken just below where she lived. She's on the ground and she's taken this picture. The couple would stand there so that wandering mobs would not set fire to the shop of their landlord, who was a Muslim. One night they witnessed how a wealthy Hindu family arrived from Karachi and forcibly occupied the house. The family set up a famous shop that continues to be there even today. Her landlord's family fled to the camps at Purana Kila and could never return after that. So for me, this is one way of looking at partition. You know, when people say, why didn't she shoot partition? I say that partition could equally be looked at by absence, at, you know, by what was not taken or by what was concealed. And this picture for me is representative of that business of concealment. I'm going to pause now and show you a clip from my film Three Women and a Camera that was made in 1998 to give you a context of press photography at the time. What were the kind of pictures that Homai was talking about? So I'm wondering if we can just go back to the clip. If you just, yeah, if I can just shut that. Just a minute. Should I just go down? And right here. Give me just a second to work out this. Yeah, I'll do it. One and we go here, and we go here. Okay.
I don't like this sort of picture.
Why do you like this?
I know this was happening, but the cameraman should have avoided drawing their attention to himself. This is everybody wanting to look at the camera and take the picture when the picture was taken. Now, these are all crowd pictures. This is a nice picture with a little touch of brightness. That is very attractive. I don't like this picture at all because it makes a prime minister look more like a clown against these dignified people. After all, you know, you have to show dignity in a person, not to make him look like a clown.
Okay, so we'll just quit this and come back to the slide presentation, which is... Is that it? Yeah. And come back here, right? Yeah, great. Okay. Now, this was the era when candid photography was popularized. In this clip, you see Homai discuss a photograph taken by one of its most famous proponents, Henri Cartier-Bresson. The photograph is an example of what Bresson termed the decisive moment, that precise section, second when all the elements of the picture fall into place. But Homai's critique of the image gives us insights about the aura and reverence attached to the bodies of public figures in India at the time. So there's a very big difference between what Henri Cartier-Bresson could take and what Indian press photographers could do at this time. They could not be photographed like in Bresson's pictures. This is not surprising given the moment when leaders were literally heroes. And photographers were also citizens who believed in the dreams that they offered them. So this is a euphoric moment. You have to remember that it's a moment when they believed that things would change and things would be different. And also, there was another reason for this. India did not have a tradition of independent photography till much later. And so for a long time, press photographers were dependent in some way or the other on the state. You know, they were guided by the state or they were controlled by the government. Of course, this restraint did not stop Homai from capturing candid moments. The method she adopted was different. So she was unobtrusive, and she often waited for what she called the right moment when all the photographers had taken their pictures, and she got the picture that she actually wanted. So she was just patient. She would just wait and watch and then capture these really candid moments. What you also see in the earlier clip that I showed you is Homai's determination about not compromising the dignity of her subjects. For instance, she did not exhibit this photograph of Prime Minister Nehru receiving Ho Chi Minh in 1958 publicly for many years. And the reason for that is that because this photograph was taken spontaneously as they chatted, the image captures Nehru gesticulating with his hand. However, the formation of their bodies in motion caught by the camera makes it seem like the Prime Minister was pulling the Vietnamese Premier's beard. In turn, Homai's subjects trusted her enough to let them photograph them in more private moments. So you know, this picture, say, of Nehru. This is on the first BOAC flight, the jet, in 1961, and then it, the next flight actually crashed, but this is one of those test flights, and that's the wife of the Deputy High Commissioner to Britain at the time. This is her personal favorite picture of Nehru hugging his sister, Vijayalakshmi Pandit, at Palam Airport. She had just arrived. She was the ambassador to Moscow, and she had just arrived in Palam, and, you know, this is one of her personal favorites. Now, a man once walked up to Homai at an exhibition, and I was witness to this, and he said, "Why have you shot so many pictures of Nehru?" And it's a telling statement, because there is no doubt that Jawaharlal Nehru dominated Homai's photographs. Extremely camera friendly, he was not averse to performing for photographers, and you see that in this picture. Homai's photographs also urge us to confront a version of history in which important events and iconic leaders dominated. And, you know, I don't even want to get into the whole idea of subaltern history. I'm sure everybody is very familiar with that. But that's the kind of history that she was documenting, a particular version of history. In this story, some people led and others followed. For instance, in her pictures, we often see leaders juxtaposed against large crowds of ordinary citizens. That's Nehru. And these pictures with Edwina Mountbatten. And these pictures created their own mythologies and collective memory. So for every exhibition, you know, we would mark this as August 16th, 1947, and people would come to us and say, you've got it wrong. It's August 15th, 1947, and she had to correct people and say, no, it's not 15th August 1947. The unfurling of the flag happened on 16th August 1947 because everybody was very tired after the midnight, you know, speech, etc. In independent India, the new government required press photographers to document the rituals of their arrival. This included oath-taking ceremonies, inaugurations, and a variety of public functions. Attention was given to the documentation of new steel plants, dams, and industries, along with national and cultural rituals. Here are some of the images of the other events that she photographed. The first Republic Day parade, which, of course, contrary to what we think, was actually at the near the Purana Kila at Irvine Stadium on August 26, 1950. And this was the first Republic Day parade at India Gate in 1951. She's climbed to the top of India Gate, and she's taken that picture. The building of dams and steel plants. This is the Durgapur steel plant. A variety of state visits to the new nation. So that's Jackie Kennedy with 1962 with Indira Gandhi arriving at the airport. I'm just going to show you a few. Martin Luther King and his wife Coretta Scott King with Nehru. Helen Keller and Queen Elizabeth, of course, her visit in 1961. Being the only woman photographing in a crowd of men, and Dipinder made reference to this, must have been an advantage as her subjects turned to look at her. So if you look at these pictures, you can see how the Queen's attention has been caught by the presence of this one single woman photographing in a crowd of men. She looks directly at her camera. The war with China in 1962 marked Nehru's first big defeat from which he never really was going to recover. You can see him very sick. This is a few days before he passed away with Sheikh Abdullah. And these are pictures taken of her funeral, his funeral procession passing through Connaught Place in 1964. Image of Indira Gandhi with her husband Firoz, and then with Sanjay and Rajiv Gandhi when they were little. That's at the first Asian Games in Delhi. Now, while her days were spent photographing political events, this is a completely different side of her repertoire. She inhabited a completely different world at night. This is when she would replace her khadar cotton sari for a silk one and set out to cover the social life of Delhi. These images of fancy dress, fashion shows, boisterous games, Christmas parties, and sporting events represent a glimpse into a small but elite subculture of the city. The Gymkhana Club, which is this picture, had opened its doors to Indians only after independence, but its functions and membership remained as embedded in social hierarchy as before. In these events, Britishers and elite Indians would discard all formality and let their hair down. Fancy dress parties created a world of fantasy as people wore masks to take on identities different from their own. Some invited her to take picture, and this is a strange picture. It's a British child dressed up as Lord Hanuman getting a prize from Santa Claus. It's a kind of a hybrid picture. And some would invite her to take photographs of a Christmas spent with the family. Others wanted her to capture vignettes of their stay in India, complete with the comforts of palatial homes and liver deed help. While most of the people in these photographs would never see India again, they developed deep friendships with her that lived on through letters. Homai's photographs would rest on their mantelpieces later back home. Okay, so that was a very brief whistle-stop tour of one part of Homai's archive that circulated in publications during her career. Homai gave up photography in 1970, and having been a professional working woman for 33 years, and this is a telling picture because she gave up photography just before 1970. She kind of began to dislike the what she calls the arrogance of Indira Gandhi. She's very critical of the emergency that followed. She began to kind of resent the way the security would actually tell, you know, stop photographers now. And you can see her in that picture actually telling people to kind of, you know, move out of the frame. And she gives up photography. Having given up photography and being a professional woman, working woman for 33 years, she slipped with absolute ease one day into the life of a homemaker, never looking back once again on her career. Most people forgot her existence as a photographer in Delhi as she moved to Pilani to live with her only son, Farooq. Very tragically, he died very young at the age of 42. And then she moved to Baroda and continued to live there in complete anonymity for 23 years, where nobody knew her and she lived on her own. For want of time, I'm now going to make a cut to the rediscovery and representation of Homai Vairavala. In 1993, a photographer called Satish Sharma located Homai in a list of men, and he organized a major exhibition of her work in Delhi in 1993 that highlighted some of the work that I have described so far, right? I met Homai in 1997. This was also the year marking 50 years of India's independence, when the birth of the nation was being reconstructed through largely political histories. It's not surprising, therefore, that this work that I have described earlier marks what I would say, as if I've called this talk The Many Lives of Homai Vairavala. Maybe it marks the first life of, or the second life of Homai Vairavala, you know, where she's known for her political pictures. And perhaps this also guided Homai's stories and narratives that traced a nationalist discourse, because you have to realize that the most common questions being asked of her in 1997 by journalists were questions to do with the nation. You know, who did you photograph? Which is the most important picture that you missed? You know, what was your relationship with icons of the time? Whether it was, you know, Mountbatten. Unfortunately, I forgot to put in a picture of Jinnah, but, you know, Jinnah, Mountbatten, Nehru, you know, these were people that she interacted with. And these were the questions that were being asked of her in 1997. Every single magazine, you know, Outlook, India Today, wanted pictures of the nation. It was a commemorative year. And it was her pictures that were being printed up because she was the one person who had actually maintained and kept her archive very carefully. Then there was also the novelty of rediscovering Homai as a woman photographer. And I would see my own role as kind of contributing to that. So my film comes out in 1998. I write my book on her in 2006. And for me as a woman, you know, Dipinder talked about the fact that I am also a camera woman. I'm a filmmaker, but I actually specialize in camera work, and I've shot many documentaries. And I was very fascinated by the whole idea of locating a legacy of women with the camera. And I think Homai for me became this driving kind of passion, because here was a woman who had operated the camera at a time when women did not use technology in the same kind of way. And so I think that this whole business of her being a pioneering woman photographer, that part of her life got highlighted through perhaps my work a lot more. And I was driven, I guess, by an imperative to reconstruct a history of firsts. You know, of her lens of looking at the world, her place as a woman in a public arena dominated by men, which is politics at that time in India, her relationship with technology that we now see as an analog history. So let me show you another clip from the film where you see her with that technology. So we need to minimize this. I should let you do it. Minimize it and go to the clips. And come to the first one. I think it should be this one. No, okay, cancel. Yeah, no, I think it should be this one here. Yeah.
Holding the camera like this, I can keep both my eyes open and just look through like that. So I can see whatever is happening in that particular frame at the same time what is happening around me. Then this is another viewfinder which I can use. which shows only the framing of the picture. And the focusing is done here, just like that, you know, forward and backwards. So all in a hurry, I just to shift this, take the picture, without any bother about focusing. And my pictures always used to come out proper focus. And after every shot, had to open this, remove the bulb, put it back, put another one. And I used to carry my camera like this on my shoulder, always. So this used to become the ashtray for the people, more or less.
She says that used to become the ashtray for other photographers. Okay, so let's come back to the PowerPoint. Right here. And this one. Yeah. Okay. So, as you saw in the film, let me go back here. Yeah. As you saw in the film, Homai used a Speed Graphics pacemaker. That's the name of the camera. It's a medium format camera. She also used a Rolleiflex. And these medium format cameras, as you can see, were still very bulky and slow. They used 12 exposures, and photographers had to be very careful in framing before the film ran out. I have argued in the past that this accounts for a much more deliberate, restrained, and slow press photography. So again, it's the analog history I'm talking about as compared to, let's say, the endless clicks that you can do on the digital. And one of the arguments that I've made in the past is that the fact that there were just 12 exposures made you very restrained. You had to take that perfect frame. You couldn't afford to waste, because then you'd have to put in a new roll and then add in another 12. And so it accounts for a certain kind of deliberate way of shooting, which is very different from the kind of way, the fast photography that you have today with the digital. And it had a different kind of charm and importance. So as my friendship with Homai grew over the years, I realized that her engagement with technology was not limited to the camera. Homai had always done her own printing, and so this is, of course, letters that she wrote to me in her beautiful handwriting, and she hated my handwriting, and her big, I think she died kind of upset with me for not being able to write handwritten letters to her, because I just couldn't, every time I wrote handwritten letters, she said, I can't understand your handwriting, because, you know, I'm so used to the computer, my handwriting is dreadful, and it, I mean, you have to compare with this. So I would write these computer letters, and she'd keep saying, like, you know, can't you write a letter to me, or, you know, to me on hand? And I'd say, yeah, I will next time, and all of that. So as my friendship grew, I realized that her engagement was not just limited. You know, she was this technologically savvy person. She had always done her own developing and printing. Over the years, she would painstakingly fashion negative jackets made from butter paper. So remember that there's no archive looking after her work. She's maintaining, keeping her own work for like, what, 50 or 60 years. And, you know, she would annotate each negative in her beautiful handwriting. She also built her own, believe it or not, built her own furniture, stitched her own clothes, did electrical and plumbing jobs, drove a car, and created nifty household gadgets. I mean, if you see my film, which I can actually leave a copy with you, it's full of the stuff of her doing stuff with her hands. She often said that she was like Robinson Crusoe. Her island was her home in Baroda, where she lived independently to the last with her plants and a few personal photographs. So these are pictures of her home in Baroda. And these are some of the only pictures that she had in her house. The favorite picture, and that's a photograph of her son, Farooq. We now move to the next phase. These are pictures of her images being packed up to be taken to Delhi in 2010, where they now rest in a private archive, the Al-Ghazi Foundation in Delhi. This was followed by a major retrospective of her work that I curated at the National Gallery of Modern Art in three Indian cities. Homai traveled to every venue, this is in Bombay, and she personally supervised the hanging of the photographs. So you can see her here in her wheelchair. We would wheel her around, putting up, you know, banners for the show. This is in Bombay, signing, you know, autographing prints for people. And next to her own photograph taken many years ago. But the interesting outcome of this show was that they reintroduced Homai Vyarawala to some of her own work. And by that, what I mean is that these were photographs that, so we were constantly opening up new work, and these were photographs that she had not seen for over half a century, because remember that the only work that she had actually printed up was her political work, mostly. And we were kind of now digitizing her negatives and finding new and new stuff, and it was fascinating just to see her reaction. Her memory was all there, you know, so she would say, oh, this is so-and-so, or this is so-and-so, or sometimes she wouldn't remember. And with every show, we opened up new negatives, especially those from her life spent in Bombay in the 1930s and 1940s. And as the exhibition traveled from Delhi to Bombay and then to Bangalore, because the NGMA is in all these three different cities, the space given to what Homai called her important pictures, photographs of iconic moments of nation building and their architects shrunk. Because for me, it became more and more important to kind of show other stuff. So with every exhibition, we'd have less of the political pictures and more of these new pictures that we were rediscovering. Much of this work was also commissioned work, but I'd now like to direct your attention towards these photographs, which are taken at the interstices of her more public frames that have been the focus of a new show that I'm currently curating on her. I've just finished one exhibition in Delhi, and now it's moving to the National Gallery of Modern Art in Bombay next year, early next year. These pictures suggest that Homai Vyarawala was observing other worlds keenly that included the inner and outer lives, particularly of young women like herself. They also suggest that the move to Delhi may have prematurely stopped a very significant direction that her work could have taken. As a press photographer, she documented all the iconic moments of Indian independence and the building of the nation. However, the need to represent famous people and important events also diverted her gaze away from other more ordinary representations of everyday life. And that's what I'm actually going to now show you. By now, we had started to digitize the work, which was opening up the archive in unexpected directions. Looking at the entire repertoire of contact sheets offered a glimpse into what came before and after selections made by her to be printed up. So basically, what I was doing was I was looking at the final photograph that she printed up, let's say, in a publication, and I was looking at what came before and what came after. What in film terminology we often call the outtakes, you know, stuff that you have not printed up. And we were finding fascinating stuff there. The digital, and of course, I have to say that the digital file or the thumbnail gave me a different sense of the sheer volume of work, because, you know, digitization offers you different kinds of advantages. And it also was allowing me to access the images very minutely because of the mouse. I could kind of zoom in and I could look at the picture carefully. And I'll come back to this point at the end. So let me get to some of those pictures. So these are some photographs of Bombay in the 1930s, where she explores just her surroundings, urban space, and architecture. I'm just going to take you through some of these pictures. These are all late 1930s, early 1940s. This is Kalba Devi Road in Bombay on the occasion of Diwali. Landscapes, streets, you know, just streets of Bombay. The zoo in Bombay, this is late 1930s. The Ganpati procession in Bombay. And these pictures are quieter, more reflective than her overtly political pictures. Some of them are much more performative and posed. That's at the Victoria Terminus in Bombay, Gateway of India during the monsoon. I also found myself revisiting pictures that I had used in my book 9 years ago. Let me take the example of her photographs taken for the British Information. So she was employed by the British Information Services in Delhi. And the pictures that I'm going to show you now had appeared in publications as propaganda for the Second World War. But now when I began to look at these pictures, I began to look at them as a keen documentation of an analog world of technology and infrastructure that is actually now we don't have any longer. So, you know, the building of the radio, for instance, you know, just it's for me, these are now pictures about analog technologies. So I guess what I'm trying to suggest is that if you throw aside context for a minute and you say, okay, so we know that this is a picture which was published during the Second World War, propaganda, et cetera, but at the same time, it's also a documentation of an analog world that we don't actually have today. So just, you know, weather mapping, just technologies that she was actually documenting. And then, of course, you know, there were moments when the actors of these performances would have a more playful engagement with the photographer. So these are, let's say she's shooting this doctor in an operation theater, and then suddenly he takes over the camera and he decides to click a picture, you know, or the nurses decide to do a little dance for her. So these are different kinds of ways of looking at these images. Then there were the scores of pictures of women in fashion shows and fancy dress. In my book, I had marked some of these pictures, these Brides of India, and which was a very big tradition at that time, Brides of India, Costumes of India, as part of a, you know, you can see the map of India in the background, as markers of the Nehruvian idea of unity in diversity, right? There was a lot of this unity in diversity thing happening in the 1950s. But again, I began to look at these pictures now as documents of a world of fashion and masquerade. So if Homai's earlier work offers a sense of a Nehruvian moment in terms of politics, we could ask what happens to our notions of Nehruvian India when we begin to define it through the lens of fashion or, you know, fancy dress or whatever. And I will show you just some of these pictures that speak of the pleasures of adornment, of appearing and being seen. The imprint of Nehru is strong, you know, whether it's in the clothes that are worn by expatriate children or the staging of unity and diversity against a map of India. Yet others are in conversation with global fashion. If you look at this picture, for instance, Nehruvian India is a kaleidoscope of competing aspirations where national and personal desires collide. In my text accompanying these pictures in the show, I asked, I quote, "What does it mean to be an Indian? What is Indianness? Can outsiders merely masquerade as Indians, or do they also constitute the idea of being Indian? Irony and ambivalence sit playfully in the heterogeneity of actors who perform the Indian. This gives us pause to ask, who could be an Indian?" So that's some of those are some of the ideas that I was actually exploring with these photographs. Now, the digitization of Homai's archive also prompted me to relook at her photographs of institutional and educational histories from the early and mid-1940s. I will use two examples. These are photographs of students at the Sir J.J. School of Arts in Bombay and at Lady Irwin College in Delhi. I apologize for this. I realized that I had got the wrong file. And this made me, you know, so she had actually photographed the J.J. School of Arts in the 1940s, early 1940s, and Lady Irwin College. I don't know whether you know very much about it in Delhi, but it was the premier institution at that time that trained women to be homemakers. So my mother, sitting right here, was actually studied at Lady Irwin College. And, you know, this was supposed to be what the middle class woman was supposed to do, to be trained to be a good homemaker. So you learned cooking and you learned tailoring and you learned sewing and you learned music so that you could be a good homemaker, right? Now, when I had put this work in my book again in 2006, I had framed it in a somewhat unidimensional way. For instance, I had framed the Lady Irwin pictures, you know, I had seen it in within an ideological framework because of the emphasis on domesticity and the home. But now, if I didn't look at them as institutional histories and I looked at what was happening, so these are again J.J. School of Arts pictures of women at, you know, or in Lady Irwin College pictures. But if I looked more carefully at the pictures, you know, so here she is, okay, so let me explain this. Here she is documenting all these institutional histories. She's taken all the pictures of the school. And then you look at all the photographs, all the negatives that she hasn't used, and you find these amazing pictures where the women who are studying in these institutions want to pose like film stars. So they have other kinds of desires. They don't want to be seen in those pictures. Outside of those pictures, these are the kinds of pictures that they want to be seen in. You know, so they ask her to take these collaborative pictures of themselves where they want to pose in different, and there are scores and scores of pictures of women getting themselves photographed with just their legs or just their hands or just their bodies. And it's telling a different kind of story of women's desires, you know, outside of those institutional histories. So at Lady Irwin College, for instance, I began to look at the women who are like actors, who were just performing the role of homemakers in these simulated, you know, there were these practice cottages where you had to simulate the home. And I began to wonder what it would be to look at these pictures merely as performances of being good homemakers. And instead, what her, you know, what her interaction with these women is bringing out or creating are much more performative and collaborative pictures. And here I'd like to draw upon two very important formulations. One, an entire body of work on the emergence of what could be called the modern girl or the modern woman, where the camera was one of the ways, though not the only one, by which women imagined themselves as being modern. So work by Liz Connor suggests that appearing and being seen by the camera could be seen as a modern act. And I think it was very critical for women in the 1930s and the 1940s. The second reference is to the work of an Israeli scholar, Ariella Azoulay. In a completely different context of Palestine, Azoulay has made a distinction between the photographed event and the event of photography. One is a photographed event, so you're photographing, let's say, something which is happening in front of the camera. But she says there's a difference between the event of photography, what you're photographing, and the photographed event and the event of photography. The event of photography would be everything that happens when the photographer, the subject, and the space interact with each other. And something interesting comes out of that too. So it's not just about what she's photographed, but what that collaboration is actually bringing out. And that's what I'm referring to here. She suggests that the event of photography is a much more dynamic synergy. It's a language, a chemistry, a relationship of affect, you can call it any of those things that happen because of the interaction of the photographer, her subjects, and the space because of the presence of the camera. You see that in these photographs as the young women that Homai photographs at the JJ School of Arts or Lady Irwin College pose for the camera in more collaborative ways once they have taken pictures of them at work. So these are the pictures here. And clearly the women want to be photographed in other kinds of ways. So this striking young woman dominates many of Homai Vyarawala's photographs. Her name is Rehana Mughal. She was her classmate at the JJ School of Arts in the late 1930s. And she plays different roles in these performative photographs. She was her favorite model. We see her in one of Homai's earliest pictures taken in 1937 as she poses with abandon at a girl's picnic with her head thrown back and palm across her face like a diva. In this picture, the decorum normally associated with well-brought-up young ladies is thrown to the winds as she draws her sari up to her knees, draping it like a Roman toga. In another photograph, she poses like Cleopatra. That's this one, sorry. I didn't get all of them in order, for an advertising assignment and sensuously shuts her eyes. In one of Homai's more famous photographs, she chips away at a sculpture in a workshop along with another classmate. The image is a powerful one as it reverses the traditional expectations of who gazes at whom in art. So it's normally women who were the subject of, you know, artists. Unlike other photographs taken by Homai of drawing sessions at the school, this one has a bare-bodied male model on display in the background. These images of Rehana Mughal are representative of the idea of the modern girl. Now, Preeti Ramamurthy has pointed out how its most visible representation was that of the urban collegiate young woman. Ramamurthy's works focuses on the 1930s Anglo-Indian actress in Bombay cinema, and she has suggested that this more transgressive and fashionable figure was edged out by the imperatives of cultural nationalism. So basically, her argument is that once independence came, nationalism required women to be wearing saris or, you know, and to be a particular kind of way, and so that transgressive figure of the Anglo-Indian woman who would dress fashionably in like skirts and dresses, etc., was edged out. Now, others have subsequently, I wouldn't say challenged, but kind of reworked this theorization to suggest that modern girls have been part of every era. You can't say that the modern girl went away in the 1930s. Modern girls were part of every era. Perhaps the only thing that happened is, and I would suggest, that they had to perform to be good girls now. So they had to change their appearance, but they were still modern, but they were performing to be what you would call good girls. And so perhaps this picture will illustrate what I'm saying. This is a hand-colored picture published in 1941. It's titled A Silent Tear. It's again Rehana Mughal. But despite the prominent teardrop beneath her eye and her pensive expression, it's hard to miss the fashionable crinkled hair under the covered head, the georgette sari, which was very fashionable at the time, and Rehana's lipstick. So these are all the accoutrements of the modern girl that are still very much there. If fashion and performativity were one of the markers of the modern girl, travel and mobility were another. Am I running okay for time? Yeah. This pair of pictures features women travelers at the Mole station at the dockyard located at Ballard Pier in Bombay. wearing dresses, high-heeled shoes and hats. The women clutch at their bags tightly. All of them return the gaze of the photographer, a woman just like themselves, with some amount of distrust. They seem slightly out of place, as if they do not belong. The women look like they could be Anglo-Indian. With the arrival of independence in 1947, this community was increasingly isolated, as they were considered outsiders by both the Indians and the British. That isolation can be sensed in this second picture, in which an unescorted woman stands separate from the more traditionally clad native Indian men around her. She holds on to her parasol. Shielding oneself from the harsh rays of the sun was as important as protection from the rain. In a deeply racist colonial society, the color of one's skin mattered profoundly, particularly if you were Anglo-Indian. Despite the mobility that these memsahibs seem to have, the photos have a poignancy because they also suggest their isolation and vulnerability. The next set of pictures, taken in the late 1930s, are symbolic of the chances that some of these young women may have had on their onward journey that may have been interrupted by larger events over which they had little control, and I'm talking about independence. The pictures capture fleeting and carefree moments of leisure when subversive ideas are born. Young women swing from the banyan trees in abandon as their friends look on in lazy indulgence. Four young women sit with their legs in water at a picnic as others sketch on the banks. The camera catches a private reverie as a young girl lies on her back with her eyes half shut under the open sky. These images represent the might-have-been possibilities of their lives. As a certain idea of the modern girl came under attack, the lives of these young women may have changed too. Perhaps some of them were domesticated by marriage and the demands of cultural nationalism. Others may have led subversive inner lives even as they perform the roles of good girls. Now, while it might be simplistic to assume that the modern girl disappeared completely, there is no doubt that a certain kind of image of a fashionable woman began to be viewed with suspicion in cinema and advertising, at least. We see this subtle transformation in Homa Vyarawala's own persona as well. Her relocation to Delhi coincided with other shifts in her personal life. By 1942, Homa was married with a child. There were pressures of being the only woman in a man's world. Surrounded by much greater scrutiny as the only woman press photographer, Homai's survival in a political arena dominated by men depended upon stripping away of a more obvious sexual presence. She now welcomed the nickname Mummy, given to her by one of her colleagues. As she said, it placed her on a pedestal. So, you know, I would often ask her that, Mrs. Vyarawala, didn't you ever have any, you know, unfortunate incident with all the men? And she said, no, because one of the men started calling me Mummy as a joke. And he was much younger than me, but he was much older than me. But I welcomed that nickname because perhaps that nickname placed me on a pedestal. So it was a kind of a shrewd move because it kind of protected her. Because once you were Mummy, you were desexualized, you were protected, even if you were surrounded by men. And of course, she cultivated a morally correct persona at work, dressed in a khadi sari. Of course, her sari provided her with a safe alibi to live a more unconventional outer life. It enabled Homai to traverse the country as she photographed high-profile political events with men. It allowed her to spend her evenings unescorted as she photographed social functions. You can see her, she's the only woman in that crowd of men. It allowed her to spend her evenings unescorted as she photographed social functions at embassies, you know, expatriate functions, Delhi Gymkhana Club. We see how conforming to nationalist ideals of femininity was integral to Homai Vyarawala's professional survival as a press photographer in Delhi. Now, I'd like to end my talk with some thoughts about what changes with this new work that, you know, we are beginning to rediscover. The first thing I would say is the lack of Homai's presence, which I feel very, very strongly, because, you know, this is the first time I've had to do shows on Homai Vyarawala without a reliance on her memory, because I've always relied on her memory, and her memory was razor sharp. She was all there till the end. But while I miss her physical presence, and I miss it tremendously, I often find myself wondering, and I find myself wondering why I didn't ask her more. But at the same time, there is also, I have to say, a new kind of freedom to unmoor these photographs from context and let them stand in the new constellations that I have described before. So as a curator, it gives me a certain amount of freedom now to actually take them out of their context and to give them a certain kind of, you know, to place them in different kinds of constellations, which I think is a very exciting thing to do with photography. And related to this severance are the possibilities created, and I would like to, you know, spend a second talking about that, the possibilities created by digitization, you know, because there's always this this nostalgia for the analog. I have tremendous nostalgia. I come from a moment which is an analog. I'm a teacher of technology in Delhi, and I've taught students over analog. And, you know, we always talk about the fact that the analog can do things that the digital can't. You know, there are certain things that the analog did that the digital just cannot do. But then there are also the possibilities. It's not an either-or situation. There are also there's a loss, of course, because talking about it in this context, because we can no longer engage with the sheer materiality of the photograph, you know, or the negative. You're not touching it any longer. Our last link to context is offered by the analog, because when you look at that contact sheet, you're looking at what came before. It's helping you date the photograph. It's helping you place the photograph in context, right? So it's the clues given by the contact sheet that tell you that these photographs are from the JJ School of Arts, or they're from Delhi, and so time, and so on. But there is a certain kind of liberation, too, with the digital, and that is that these pictures can be arranged in different kinds of categorizations, offering other kinds of possible meanings. So I can put them in different kinds of digital files and create new kinds of meaning. So let's take, you know, just one example. Let's say these two pictures, which are from completely different places. The one on the left is women looking at the skeleton, studying the skeleton at Lady Irwin College in Delhi in the mid-1940s, because, you know, you had to study the physiology of the body. The one on the top, you know, to the right, is students of the JJ School of Arts looking at the skeleton, because, of course, you have to look at the skeleton to be able to understand how to draw. But when you put those two pictures together, they could actually end up becoming a comment on the banality of death, because, you know, death is always this really horrible, terrible thing, and here, you know, people are kind of just touching the skeleton as if, you know, it was just any ordinary object. So I find this juxtaposition interesting. You know, these are pictures that we discovered from the 1940s that today are very contemporary because they are about gender crossing. So this is a performer from the 1940s turning into a woman, and there's a whole series of these pictures which were very interesting in the new exhibition that we put together. So back to Homai. In 2008, at the age of 96, she traveled across the Atlantic, making her first ever journey abroad. I'm going to show you two short clips of Homai during that journey. I was invited by Harvard to come and speak there. They had no idea that she was alive. And when I told them that she was alive, they said, would she like to come? And I asked her, and she said she was 96 then. And she said, why not? And I said, okay. And everybody then started to say, what have you done? Are you mad? You're going to take a 94-year-old woman across the Atlantic? She's never traveled, and she had never traveled abroad ever in her life. And they said, you know, she will have thrombosis on the flight. Something will happen to her. And I have to say, she was absolutely great. And I'm going to show you two clips, one from London. She visits Tavistock Park, where she sees a photograph of a man that she's photographed many times before, that's Gandhi, and you'll see her critique of the statue. And then there's a short clip where I shot her in Harvard, and I asked her how she felt. So I just want to play those clips for you. They're just 2 minutes. So I go down here. Yeah, I'm done. I'm just going to wind up now.
Must have a spectacles on
him. He doesn't have
spectacles. Yeah, it's a bit funny. He doesn't have spectacles. He's looking a bit unlike Gandhi.
Yeah. But anybody, you know, half dressed is Gandhi. Please do not
remove.
It looks like some offering only. चलो कोई तो याद करते हैं हमारे वाले नहीं करते तो क्या हो गया?
She says at least somebody remembers Gandhi even if we don't remember him in our country. This was in 2008.
Thank you.
Do you like the picture?
Very much. It is exactly how I feel even now. You know? Cares the hoot about what people say. I have to do my work and I do it. That's all.
Good
That's
for you.
My attitude.
Good for you.
Even now it's the same attitude. If they don't like me, it's their problem, not mine. If they like me, I'm very happy. Even now when I wanted to come here, people were trying to, you know, sort of frighten me off, saying, no, it will find it difficult, it will be too cold, and, you know, at this age, how will you manage? I said, never, no risk, no premium. You don't gain anything out of it if you don't risk. If I fall ill, that's my bad luck.
The 9th of December, yes?
That clip on the visit,
yes.
The last part with the police siren,
yeah,
in the background, is very interesting.
That's an interesting juxtaposition. Yeah.
Yes.
It must have happened while we were shooting, yeah. Thanks for that.
It's very touching.
Yeah. So the 9th of December 2011 was Homai's 98th birthday. And I had never ever visited her on her birthday, but I don't know what it was. It was just an instinct. I decided to give her a surprise. So I landed up in Baroda and I texted her. She, by the way, at the age of 98, she had learned how to use WhatsApp, had learned how to do SMS, text. So I texted her saying, I've just landed in Baroda, because she couldn't hear the phone, right? So she wrote back saying, wonderful, when will you come? And I said, tomorrow morning, because I didn't want to disturb her at night. And the next day was her birthday. It was one of the loveliest days that I spent with her. I just spent that one day with her. You know, we went out, we had a little celebration for her with 2-3 friends in the evening, because she lived on her own. And the next morning, before leaving, I said, I want to just take a short video with you. And I shot a small video with her. And I said, how do you feel? And she said, I still feel young. And she said, she spoke about a disobedient and ailing body that she described as a broken house. She said, my body is like a broken house. It's like a shipwreck. It's broken. But the person who lived in it is still young. She said, I'm still young. So as we bid farewell to that ailing body, we carry forward the memory of the truly extraordinary and forever young Homai Vyarawala that I knew. The woman who captured history through her photographs, but also created history as she ran with her cameras across the frame of an archival film. I'm going to end now with a 3-minute clip from a film that I made as a tribute to her when she died. You'll see the archival footage right at the end, but before that you'll see her traveling through different landscapes, through Delhi, through Harvard, through Chicago, because it was one of the most incredible things that we did when we took her on that. I mean, for me it was one of the most incredible experiences of my life, to take a 94-year-old woman across the Atlantic, somebody who's never seen the West, and to look at the West through her eyes. It's a film that I'm making now. I haven't completed it, but I'm going to show you clips. So that's the last clip, and I'll end, and then I'm very happy to take questions.
Thank you.
right.